Negative Happy Chainsaw Edge was first published as a novel in 2001 by author Takimoto Tatsuhiko. His work was later adapted into a movie and a graphic novel in 2008, both by the same title. The story basically follows the two main characters, a high school girl called Eri and a boy called Yosuke, as they fight against an 8-foot-tall, chainsaw-wielding monster man, who they refer to as the Chainsaw Man. However, the story does more than entertain its viewers and readers with action sequences. It is, in essence, a tale of overcoming adversity and defeating our inner demons, with the help, perhaps, of the Chainsaw Man. This analysis will primarily focus on exploring what the Chainsaw Man is, why it attacks Eri, and how he is defeated. Although he is in many ways Eri's demon, she's not the only one to be affected by him. Yosuke, in fact, plays a big part in his demise. As the original novel has not been translated, the analysis will be based on the movie and the graphic novel. Before delving deeper into the plot itself, it is interesting to observe some of the comments made by Carol Clover in her book Men, Women, and Chainsaws. Although she primarily focuses on gender in the modern horror film, she also mentions some key aspects of slasher films that are a part of the identity of the Chainsaw Man. Her book was published in 1993, while the movie and graphic novel being analyzed were released in 2008. In a way, the movies she talks about in her study are what shape up the identity of the monster of our story. When characterizing the killer in slasher films, Clover describes the monster as one whose only role is that of a killer and one whose identity as such is clear from the outset. She continues by saying that they are usually large, sometimes overweight, and often masked. They may be recognizably human, but only marginally so. Finally, she enunciates the supernatural capacity of killers. They are virtually indestructible. And that is what the Chainsaw Man looks like. He's tall and large, he's corpulent. His face can't be seen properly, and from the first moment he is shown, the audience recognizes him as evil. What is more, he never seems to die, in spite of getting stabbed and cut again and again in the heart. As a villain, he would almost seem formulaic, cliched, but there is a reason why he fits into Clover's model so precisely. And that is because Eri, the girl he constantly tries to kill, needs him to look like that.
お父さんとお母さん、それに弟、交通事故、酔っ払い運転の暴走トラック、運転してた人、ごめんなさい、ごめんなさいって言ってた。
As we learn about Eri's past, we understand that she needed an enemy, she needed an opponent, a reason. If there is sadness and pain in the world, it must be caused by something or someone. After all, Eri is a teenager living in the 21st century, which means she has likely been exposed to all the movies Carol Clover talks about. We grow up consuming media that tells us about the existence of absolute evil, of things that must be defeated at all costs for the main characters to live peacefully, of terrible sharks, evil vampires, vicious werewolves, and chainsaw men. It makes sense, then, that a girl who has just lost her family to something as senseless as a car accident would need to search for a higher reason. And it is in that way that the Chainsaw Man is created. He is the externalization of Eri's inner demons. He is what she needs him to be, an opponent to be defeated. He's everything bad in the world. He's the reason her parents died and the people she loved moved away. Psychoanalyst Melanie Klein talks about the early development of a child's conscience by explaining that children go through a stage where they displace the source of their inner anxieties to the outside world and turn the objects of the outside world into dangerous objects, but that in the long run, the dangerous objects will not dissipate until the child's own aggressive instincts dissipate first. This can very much be applied to the relationship between Erie and the Chainsaw Man, with the only difference that the Chainsaw Man does indeed become real. He can hurt Erie and Yosuke, and he can make them bleed. The reason he has a chainsaw is therefore made clear. Erie associates chainsaws with evil, so her monster needs to have one. But why does Erie never fight back with a gun? In the graphic novel, she mostly uses knives and a sword. In the movie, she uses knives and different objects ranging from a wooden sword to a golf club. Here we can return to Clover's observations. She says that closeness and tactility are also at issue. Knives and needles, like teeth, beaks, fangs, and claws, are personal extensions of the body that bring attacker and attacked into primitive, animalistic embrace. Because the Chainsaw Man stems from Erie's own feelings, he is primitive. Erie therefore needs to fight him at a basic level, the way a knight would battle a dragon. To aid her in her need to fight, she received supernatural abilities herself. Although she can still get hurt, she becomes incredibly agile and light to make battling easier for her. Erie has been fighting the Chainsaw Man since her family's funeral. But as she meets and befriends Yosuke, the both of them begin to notice changes in the monster. It gradually starts to weaken as the friendship between the two teenagers deepens. It is easier for Erie to dodge his attacks, for example. That is, until Yosuke tells Erie that he'll have to move to another town because of his parents. From that point onwards, the Chainsaw Man becomes more powerful and gains more abilities. It can completely overpower Erie because, as she says, the sadder she is, the stronger he becomes. The final confrontation between the Chainsaw Man and Erie is also the one where the monster is the strongest, because it takes place the day before Yosuke has to leave. Erie is almost killed, but survives because of a chainmail armor she was wearing, which was given to her by Yosuke. What saves her from her death is therefore Yosuke's help, and her acceptance of his help. The defeat of the Chainsaw Man is brought forth by Yosuke's attack on him. He throws himself and the motorbike he is riding straight into the monster, willing to sacrifice himself for Erie. And it is the sacrifice he tries to make that serves as evidence of his strong bond with Erie. It is as though he were proving to the Chainsaw Man that Erie is not alone. In view of this, the Chainsaw Man disappears. He is defeated in this one battle and never appears again, because Erie now has someone to help her deal with her losses and move on with her life. She no longer has to focus on the unfairness of the world. Instead, she can try to be happy. The Chainsaw Man undoubtedly still exists inside her, because she will feel sadness again at some point. But she is now more prepared to fight this sadness internally, rather than to have it externalized.
Chainsaw Otoko wa kieta kedo, sekai wa bara-iro ninatta no ka? Kekkyoku 何も変わってないよな。俺はダラダラと生きてるだけだし、悲しいことだってきっとなくならない。だけど、だからどうした？とも思う。少なくとも今この瞬間はエリちゃんも俺もそれなりにハッピーなんだし。